Howdy, I am Quick Draw McGraw, and it's very hard palated.
Same way as Huckleberry High, huh?
Yogi Bear is a lot of diaphragm. Yay!
Snagglepuss, the same way. Diaphragmic control.
Read the authorized biography of cartoon voice magician Doss Butler. Just one of the books available from Waterlog.com. That's Waterlog with two G's. .com.
Yay! Yay!
Hello there! I is Professor Ludwig von Whatchamacallit, your tour guide through the world of phantasmagorical audio treasures. I see you got inside before the avalanche slid up against the front door. Boy, what a blizzard out there! We is trapped inside Bear Manor. But it's okay because we have our smart aleck phone with us to listen to all the BearManor radio theater shows while we wait for someone to dig us out. Number one, the voice actor show with David Ossman. Oh, David Ossman from Firesign Theatre. He is one funny fella, I tell you. Number two, Laurie's Book Nook with Sandra Grabman. Sandra is the author of Plain Beautiful, the Peggy Ann Garner story. Number three, the Jotia Show. The Lone Ranger meets the Long Ranger. Oh, look, a masked Joe Bev. He dressed the part, but you wouldn't know it because it's radio. Number four, Fred Free's Favorites. An excerpt from Plain Beautiful, the Life of Peggy Ann Garner by Sandra Grabman. She was a guest on Laurie's Book Nook, too. And Son of Harpo Speaks by Bill Marx. Oh, I love the Marx Brothers. Harpo's my favorite, but he wasn't so good on the radio because he didn't do any talking. Look at that. You get some of two different audiobooks for free at the same time. Number five, Aroma Time Radio. Foods that beat the winter blues. Food? Why did I say food? I got no food. I guess I will check the maid's kitchenette to see if there are any scraps left from their holiday party. Number six, the Lost OTR Show, the conclusion of The Big Show with Tallulah Bankhead from February 24th, 1952. Wow, that is a big show. So big they had to play it in two parts, and Tallulah was a big star. I wish I could see a star through this big snowstorm. Number seven, Audio Classics Archive, Screen Directors Playhouse 101049, number 38. Chris Cross with Burt Lancaster, Betty Lou Gerson, and Crime Classics, 7653, number 4. The shrapnel body of Charles Drew Sr. These will keep me distracted from the fact that I is really getting more hungry, but not hungry for entertainment. Number 8, the Comedy O'Rama Hour, with special guest David Ossman as George Leroy Porgy Tirebiter. Another Firesign Theatre actor on the Comedy O'Rama Hour? This should be a good one! I hope his improv skills are sharp and ready for those goofy kids at Camp Waterlog. Number 9, a Jazzorama Valentine! Oh, well, isn't that nice? We've got some nice romantic-type jazz music to keep me company. I wish I had a nice lady friend to keep me company. Number 10, Cartoon Carnival Valentine Special! Well, we has the music and the comedy that is all romantical, but no chocolates or flowers. Chocolate! I is getting even more hungry than I was before. Number 11, Cartoon Carnival President's Day Special. Oh, yes, it's almost spring and President's Day is on its way. Good idea to enjoy the days with comedy because the president is really serious stuff. Number 12, the Mid-Atlantic Nostalgia Convention Celebrity Interviews. The Making of Time Tunnel by Martin Grams. Ooh, goody, goody. He is going to learn more about that crazy steampunk-type TV show, Time Tunnel. I have to polish up my monocle and add a shine to all my brass machinery. Ooh, where are my goggles? So there you have it, the latest BearManor radio lineup, which you hear streaming 24-7 at BearManorRadio.com and podcast anytime at VaterLogWith2Gs.com. You can listen on your computer or even your smarter than a phone like we is, on an account of the blizzard that has trapped us here. So take it away, Joe Bev and David Ossman, on the Voice Actor Show! Boy, I hope they dig us out soon. I got nothing to eat around here. Oh, my stomach is making all kinds of noises and everything.
Yay! It's the voice actor show!
The voice actor show.
The voice actor show!
This is Porky Pig, and you're listening to the voice actor show, folks.
Pay attention, Doc, because you're listening to the voice actor show with Joe Bevilacqua.
And special guest,
David Ossman of Firesign Theatre.
Hi, I'm Joe Bev. This time on the Voice Actor Show, I'll be talking with my very special guest, David Ossman. David was one of the four founding members of the Firesign Theatre in 1966 and has edited all their published works, including Anything You Want To, Exorcism in Your Daily Life, and Profiles in Barbecue Sauce, all available at BearManorMedia.com. Also from Bear Manor, Ossman's The Ronald Reagan Murder Case, featuring George Tirebiter, 1940s radio star and part-time detective, and Dr. Firesign's Follies, a sort of memoir. He is presently engaged in writing a new, much expanded edition of The Sullen Art, based on his 1960s radio interviews with new American poets, and he has a new book of political poems, Marshmallows and Despair, coming this fall. David and his wife, Judith Walcott, were given a Lifetime Achievement Angie Award from the International Mystery Writers Festival, for which they produced more than a dozen new plays, including works by Mary Higgins Clark, Ray Bradbury, Rupert Holmes, and Agatha Christie's The BBC Murders, an adaptation of four of Christie's radio mysteries. David and Judith are best known for the War of the Worlds 50th anniversary production, the first all-digital radio drama in 1988, Norman Corwin's We Hold These Truths in 1991, The Empire of the Air, The Men Who Made Radio in 1992, and the all-star centennial production of The Wizard of Oz in 2000. After we talk to David Ossman, we'll play excerpts from How Time Flies, a Columbia Records comedy album from 1972, written by Ossman, and featuring the voice talents of all four of the Firesign Theatre, plus other contributors. And if you tune into one of my other radio shows, the Comedy-O-Rama Hour, David Ossman will appear as George Tirebiter. And of course, you can hear all 15 of my radio shows at waterlogwith2gs.com. And now, welcome David Ossman. Hi, David.
Hey, Joe.
It's great to have you here.
As they used to say in those 40s comedies.
That's right. I get that a lot. Hey, Joe, yeah. What do you know?
Well, it's because you still live back in that part of the country where it's still hip to be hip, you know?
It's actually still 1938 here in upstate New York.
Aren't you lucky? 1938. What a great year.
At least you were 2 years old in 1938.
I was 2 years old in 1938, and do I remember radio from then? You know, I probably I wasn't listening. Probably it was on in the kitchen, but I really right. wasn't aware of it, you know?
But did you have any awareness at all of radio theater or anything like that when you were a child?
Well, the first radio program that I remember listening to, and I've looked it up, and so I know it had to be in the winter of 1941, which I would have been five. Yeah. And it was a show called Latitude Zero, and I never forgot it because it just scared the pants off me.
Well, I've never even heard of that.
No, yeah, it took me a long time to find the right encyclopedia of old-time radio that finally answered that question for me, but it was only on for a short time in that winter 41-42 time. And I also remember Pearl Harbor, which was the day after my fifth birthday.
Right.
So I can remember the hubbub and the broadcast, and so radio was with me as a dramatic medium right from the beginning.
What was your childhood like?
Well, we lived in suburban Los Angeles and suburban San Francisco, and we lived in Mexico City for about 2 years. That had a great effect on me. I was there actually almost 3 years. So I was there during most of the Second World War time. The Second World War to me was pages of Life magazine, black and white photos.
Wow. Why were you in Mexico City?
My father was an engineer, and he was connected with a company down there, two different companies. And so we went with him on both those trips to Mexico. He also went to Guatemala and to India. And my mom went with him to India and Ceylon in the mid-1950s.
Wow.
So he traveled around quite a bit, my dad did.
What was your first performance experience like? When did you think that maybe you wanted to perform and for a living?
First performance experience versus when I thought I wanted to perform. I think those.
Well, either one, yeah, or both.
Different things. No, sure. I remember my first performance experience was in, must have been fifth grade. I was in San Francisco, and it was the Thanksgiving pageant. And I was given a wonderful prop, which was a brown paper bag with two cut-out turkey legs sticking out of the top of the bag, which I gripped in my hand, entered the stage, and said proudly, "Here is a turkey for your Christmas dinner," or Thanksgiving dinner, whatever it was. And that was it. I had this. I had the turkey in a bag, and it was their Thanksgiving. Wow. First time I ever really wanted to perform was, I probably always wanted to show off a little bit. You know, and so I would recite poems, and there was a point of time when I conducted recorded music. You know, come in and watch me.
I'm going
to do, you know, the Second Symphony here. Dun, 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 dun. Hands around. And
what a picture!
But returning to radio, I was still listening, of course, in the 50s when I was in high school, and in junior high, I did a program on the air in the school, which of course was, you know, closed circuit. PA system.
Right.
And did another anniversary program. I've been doing them all my life. This was Washington's birthday, and I wrote the script. A couple of my friends and I sat in front of the console and turned it on, and, "Hi, Bob. Well, hi, Dave. Well, say, what, you know what today is? Golly, no, what is that?" You know, sort of an IRP classroom film for the year.
Right. That's wild.
So that was pretty early on.
But those are all seeds that were planted to, you know, sort of lead you to where you've gone, you know.
I think so. I think getting into being actually on the radio on WBAI in New York, right, that came as, you know, one of those right place, right time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
not as predictable as, let's say, you know, going to work as a mail sorter at William Morris, or working as a guide at NBC, those kinds,
right,
in at the bottom jobs.
Right.
It was a phone call from a professor of mine at Columbia, who said WBAI was looking for a summer replacement announcer, and would I like to go and audition?
Right.
And very shortly after that, I was on the air all over New York City. I don't know how many FM receivers there were in 1959, but...
Yeah. Well, WBAI, even to this day, has the prime spot on the dial.
Yes, they do.
Right in the center, and it's powerful.
Yes, well, they've amped the power up since I was there. I used to have to turn on and off the transmitter.
Uh-huh.
It was owned by a billionaire cigarette paper manufacturer who lived out on Long Island, and he'd call me up in the middle of the night. Lou Schweitzer was his name, and he'd call up and say, "Read me what the amplitude gain is." You know, I'd go over there, 99.5.
Wow.
I want you to raise it a little bit. I can start to hear out here. And so we'd amp the station up so he could listen to it.
Wow. This is very interesting, because as I got into looking at your bio, your various articles about you and bios, and then hearing you talk, you sort of were one of the people that forged the way for people that came after, for Saturday Night Live, for me even, because I did radio on the PA in high school, and I started at WBAI, and ended up at NPR, and all of the very similar kinds of things.
Yes, absolutely. It was, just to widen it a bit more, yeah. Everyone who came to public radio, I mean, all the great producers came from either college radio stations or from the Pacifica stations,
right.
At the very beginning. I mean, that was right. The training platform for public radio.
Yes.
And it was still very free-form and very inventive, even when I was at NPR in 82.
Right.
They were still tending to develop new kinds of programs.
Yes, I remember.
It's not surprising that you followed the same pattern, because it's there to follow. If you're interested
right.
in broadcasting, if you're interested
right.
in sound, if your yeah. ears are open, you look for the first opportunity that you can find. And weren't we lucky that
yeah.
we could broadcast internally in our
right, exactly.
junior high, for heaven's sake.
Right, know? Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So now, you can talk about anything you want, and I'm just going to skip a little, but if you want to go back to something or talk about something I'm not asking you, feel free. I'm interested in some of the things you did at NPR. Now, you did a you were the producer of a show in the Sunday Show or something like, right?
Yeah. Yes, it was called the Sunday Show.
Yeah, I remember that.
I do. I've never really written about that experience. It remains yet to be recorded and completely analyzed, but the basic story is the Firesign Theatre had done one of everything and nobody was buying. And that
right.
was 79 and 80, and we'd gone on the road, and a lot of our road trip was really discouraging. And I was, and we had nothing in the offing, and I was offered this job producing a big program for NPR. What could I say? You know, I'd been in public radio, besides the Firesign Theatre, public radio had been my career.
Yeah.
And so I said, guys, I'm going to take a year off and see what's going on here. Nothing is happening with us anyway. So went back to New York, to Washington, D.C., and moved family and the whole thing. My wife came back with me and our cat, and we moved into one of those horrible corporate rentals. Mm-hmm. And there I was in Washington, D.C., which is a whole other story. The power struggle at NPR at the time was between a very free-form show, which I was really importing from my Pacifica radio years and from the Firesign Theatre,
right.
to what the management expected, or the higher management expected,
sure.
which was the program that became Performance Today. Essentially,
right.
they wanted a classical music performance show.
Right.
And I said, that, you know, this wasn't what I was hired to produce. And really being executive producer was not a good fit for me. Mm-hmm. Because I didn't know the ins and outs of public radio. I didn't know who producers were, and I got no help when I first was there, and had to fire my second in command, and brought in a woman who saved my life, absolutely, Deborah Jane Lamberton, who's still in Washington, D.C. at WETA, fabulous producer, knew everybody in the system, got me a staff of 17 people, and we began to work 7 days a week, 6 days a week on prep, and then a seventh broadcast day.
Yeah.
And I think the show was out at best to about 60 stations or so. But we did huge, huge productions. We did, it was a five-hour radio show.
Yeah, I remember it.
So it was 3 hours and 2 hours, or it could be just 2 hours, or just 3 hours, or 2 hours and 3 hours. And I had to, you could never write through continuity for the show
yeah.
because you never knew how it would hit the air.
Right.
So, but the experience was great. 6 hours from San Francisco, a whole feature from the Spoleto Festival in Charleston, a whole broadcast from, or series of broadcasts recorded in the Santa Fe area, all with artists all around there, and great prospects for going to other NPR stations and saying, okay, what's the art scene in your city? We did that in San Francisco. We were looking forward to doing it, you know, in New Orleans and wherever. So to make the short story even shorter, I was fired 10 minutes after I got off the air, having celebrated John Cage's 70th birthday, and told to have my office empty on Monday. It was Memorial Day weekend.
Yeah. Now, what did you do? What was the controversy about it?
Well, it had been brewing for a long time. One of the VPs strolled in and looked at our, you know, this huge chalkboard we had to arrange the show on, and looked at it and said, "Death wish," and stalked out of the room because it was too much talk. We had checkerboarded talk. They were theme shows. It was like all good radio, like Bob Dylan's XM show. They're theme oriented. Right. That was the way, that's how you organize material, was thematically. Right.
So that's why I do it. Sure.
Yeah. So I did a show on 1932, because we had a reproduction of a 1932 concert that had been recorded in L.A., original music. Nobody had ever heard this music, and it was hot in 1932. Right. And so I thought, great, that's a basis. We'll talk about Broadway, and we'll interview some, you know, I mean, we would expand the idea and bring you a picture. And this wasn't every hour of the 5 hours. This was just thematically run through the show. Yeah. So because we did have to broadcast a Beethoven piano sonata every week. That was built in. And we had a few live people, not as many, you know, live players, artists, not as many as I would have liked. We didn't do any pop music, but we came pretty close. We didn't do rock and roll, although I'm sure we would have if time had moved on and we'd been more in the boomer mainstream, I think.
Right.
So it was a very interesting year and well worth recalling in some detail. But at the moment, it's in one of those banker's boxes.
Right. But even with that awkward fit, as it were, you were able to do things that really made you feel fulfilled, and that you did something interesting on the air, and it led to other NPR things, and it's particularly radio theater, which is like impossible to get on NPR, especially now.
Well, we had Judith and I had the great good fortune of
that's your wife for the audience.
Yes,
that's your wife,
Judith Walcott, we've been married now almost 30 years, and we've co-produced, co-directed, co-written just about everything.
Some really marvelous, stunning stuff. So really stunning work, by the way.
Thank you. I'll take you back to radio movies. When we were working together at WGBH, the management there came up with a program idea of a two-hour-long drama feature like the BBC's two-hour programs. That meant we could import those programs and put them on the air here. And also there were long-form programs like The Empire Strikes Back, which NPR had produced. Hitchhiker's Guide, which was very, very popular. So we were hired to develop this program. And we did a couple of originals for it, and we started it with the first show that we did together, which was The Red Badge of Courage, which was a four half-hour adaptation of the book, which we did in the way we love to do things, which was outdoors with actors, and lots of actors running around and screaming and yelling. Yeah. And
Nice. I love it. That's what I do. I record a lot of my actors outdoors.
Being studio-bound, you just don't have to be studio bound, and this was something that this was my Cage.
It must have been harder back then. I mean, portable equipment wasn't that big.
Well, you know,
it was too big. It was big, rather.
We were in those days. You had TCD-5 cassette recorders, and that's what everything went down on. You know, because nobody could afford those big Gnagras.
Right, I started on a cassette myself. Yeah.
So from that program, from the radio movies show, we did a dozen programs, which included The Empire Strikes Back. By cutting out all the narration, we managed to get it into a two-hour chunk. And we did A Hitchhiker's Guide, and we did a couple of plays with one of the Boston theatrical companies that were really, really very good. And gradually filled out this whole season, and it was promoted on NPR and played on some stations. I don't know how many actually did run this show, but of course it wasn't popular enough, and so it was dropped out. At that time, there was a grant writing with the National Endowment for the Arts. We were the artists in the grant, and when we left WGBH, we took that grant with us, and from that did the War of the Worlds 50th anniversary production in 1988, and that was the first of our great run of 5 years as a mini studio.
I'm Joe Bev. We'll be back with more of my interview with David Ossman right after this.
You know, BearManor Media has got some really nice books. You should check out anything you want to. Shakespeare's Lost Comedies by the Firesign Theatre. It's more than just a rousing send-up of Shakespeare. Anything You Want is a full-length theatrical entertainment written and rewritten continually throughout the Firesign Theatre's long performing career. This volume collects every iambic double entendre and silly soliloquy into a surreal comedy opus, complete with Firesign's scholarly introduction, tongue-in-cheek footnotes, diagrams, and even recipes. Check out Anything You Want To, Shakespeare's Lost Comedies by the Firesign Theatre at BearManorMedia.com. Isn't it?
Boy, I sure am glad I brought my smartphone with me. Yep, being lost out here in the woods for 4 weeks, with nothing to eat but acorns. Yep, and an occasional mushroom. Yep, but at least I've got waterlog.com. Waterlog with two G's.com. Yep. You making fun of me?
Oh, look what's on the Joe Bev Experience. Download the free Waterlog smartphone app and listen to 34 free hours of audio every month and gain access to over 100 audiobooks. That's the free Waterlog smartphone app at waterlog.com. That's Waterlog with two G's .com.
You are listening to The Voice Actor Show with Joe Bev on the BearManor Radio Network. Check out all the great books and audio at BearManorMedia.com.
I'm Joe Bev, and this is The Voice Actor Show. I am speaking with David Ossman, one of the four founding members the Firesign Theater.
Just as an aside, we had a coincidence right here at Camp Waterlog here a few months ago when your son Orson showed up right next to my house here filming a movie, which was fascinating that I just bumped into him and had never met him before. But coincidences, because in 1988, I did a documentary, audio documentary on the War of the Worlds, and I was the last person to interview John Houseman, and I did Coward Koch, and I told the whole story. And a lot of the stations that ran your, like WNYC in New York City, for example, that ran your War of the Worlds production, preceded it with my little half-hour documentary.
Really? That's great. We also did a half-hour, but I didn't have the... I had the BBC's Houseman interview. I didn't have a personal interview with him. My best one, I think, was with... is it Frank Wilson, who was...
Oh, yeah, sure.
He was Wells, really, his next guy, you know. He was the guy that stood next to Wells for a long time. And I interviewed him at his place on Pacific Coast Highway. And that was really like being inside the Orson Welles comet, which is what what lifted us all up that year was wealth.
Yes, yes.
And it gave me a chance then to kind of turn back on National Public Radio. I've been away from it now, you know, doing other things, to look at what NPR was at that time and to use it as the format for the show. And so it happens on Terry Gross's local record show, in which he's playing music from 1938. Part of the reason I did that is because I realized that really Orson Welles and Howard Koch created an enormous joke. Welles admitted it only once, what a joke it was. But then he had to keep it quiet because of the panic broadcast. But it was a huge send-up of radio and a huge parody of all that news broadcasting live from Europe, you know?
And even just guy doing the weather and the high pressure system and all that.
It was just
Hausman told me they started so slowly, and that's why it worked, because it lulled the audience into a false sense of security and they thought it was real, and then
What happened was, as you may know, is it, the original rehearsal was 9 minutes long.
Yeah.
And they had to cut. Welles had to sit down and cut 9 minutes out of the script, and which he did in the second half, which is always narrative heavy and very difficult to really adapt successfully. But he added time to the first half in those empty seconds as they're shifting from one thing to another. There is actually seconds added in there. So that was really, I think, what Welles brought to that broadcast more than anything else, brought to Howard's script more than anything else, were those silences.
Right. Yeah. So now you've kind of studied this stuff as well. So, you know, you can talk about it analytically. You can see what the behind the scenes or the thought process behind the creativity is, and then apply it to your own work. Let's go back a little bit to Firesign Theatre, and of course, we don't really need to talk about how you guys got together and the history of it. It's, I think, for people that know who you are, they would know that. But when you guys were coming up with your characters and voices, I mean, how did that blossom? For instance, you know, like your George Tirebiter character is so, it's the kind of character that could leap from thing to thing, really.
You know? He was. We had a limited assembly of voices between us. Phil Proctor could actually speak French and Russian quite fluently, and he did pretty good dialects. Austin was doing Shakespeare, so he had a sort of acceptable stage Brit. I did a couple of useful things, but all of us had listened to The Goon Show, and I had been especially impressed by Peter Sellers' Major Bloodknock voice.
Yes.
Which is the English version of the really old Tirebiter. And Major Bloodknock on The Goon Show enters as if coming out of a gigantic fart. And it's one of the great radio entrances of all time. And I had picked up, I'd listened to thousands of Goon shows, so I'd picked that up, and we all had, and there were references. If you listen to Electrician, you're probably hearing the first multiple voices, and it's not terribly complicated. There are, you know, just basic accents in Waiting for Electrician and radio voices and the kinds of things that we were already doing. But the winter after we did, after we recorded Waiting for the Electrician, we did a series of a dozen radio half hours on Radio Free Oz live. And those shows, we really patterned after The Goon Show. And so we developed voices that would go, that would not be the same, but then would be useful week after week. Austin was always the straight guy. I was always the old guy. Proctor was always the Irishman, you know?
Yeah, right.
And not to leave Peter out, because Peter had his whole assortment of really absurd accents, you know, just just funny things that he would do, Arab voices, and, you know. So that really got us, I think, going in the direction of developing character voices that we could continue. And, of course, Nick Danger was written very shortly after that in early 68. Right. And that gave us all that, that defined those three voices, the big Peter Bergman, Bradshaw voice, shut up, you know, and Catherwood, who became then Tirebiter at several ages, right. And Proctor's Rocky Rococo, even though that yes. never went anyplace else, everybody's opposite was Nancy, and so that gave us all the falsetto female voices that we then right. used. There was actually a discussion at one time as to whether women ought to be in the Firesign Theater, whether we should expand our ranks, as it were.
Yeah. No, yeah, we yeah. decided not to do that. Mm.
That's right. That's right.
So,
well, you know, I do the same thing. Sometimes it depends on what it is. Sometimes I'm a woman, you see. And other times I use my wife, Lori, or some other actress. It depends on whether I want it to sound, you know, realistic or comic.
Well,
you know.
Yeah, I mean.
Doss Butler, who was my mentor, taught me to do it in, it's not really a falsetto, because if you go into a falsetto, it's Mickey Mouse, you know. It's like, hi, gang, I'm Mickey yeah, Mouse,
right,
you know.
Right.
But he used to do a woman named Dame Edith Evans, who spoke like this, Dame Edith Evans, like that. It sounds very masculine in a way. And so I use that once in a while, too, you know. So, yeah, you can do it. But it is interesting you had that conversation, really, to discuss whether or not you wanted to bring women
yeah,
into
Yeah, well, there came a point, you know, where, I mean, there three of us were married, and at least one of them was an actress. So, yeah. you know, and they did end up being used here and there in various places. But we never, once it was the four of us in the Firesign Theater, it never expanded. There were some moments when it seemed like there were only going to be three and we might have to look for a fourth. When Proctor was on the road as an actor in a touring show, you know, well, maybe we should get somebody else. David Grimm, who was our organist and pianist for those right. first couple of years, we considered, and he might have stayed with us had he not passed away very suddenly at 30 years of age.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
early
yeah.
casualty.
Right. Now, for the fans out there, without Peter, is there ever a chance you guys would do something that you would call Firesign Theater again? Because I know you've worked together in other ways. I mean, and I know Peter did a whole comedy act with Phil.
Yeah, well, Proctor and Bergman came along in the mid-70s, and they had gone to Yale together. They were a year apart at Yale, and they had an act, you know, and Austin and I all put together an act that we did several times on the road. We did two different shows. And one of them was very, you know, you play your guitar and I'll read my poetry show, which you could only have done in 1974, 75. And and the other one was a Radio Laughs of 1940, which was basically a two-man piece that had Tirebiter locked in the studio. There's a strike, and so nobody can get in or out of the radio studio except the people who were there. And he has slept overnight because he's trying to finish a script, and he wakes up the next day just in time for the daytime show, which is being done by, you know, the engineer, and has to go through the whole day appearing in various voices on the show. It was a lot of fun, and a big piece at the end of it was a Nick Danger that Austin had basically written for himself and me, and that was a really nice show. But it was very hard for the two of us, and yeah. I think the three of them, when I was not in California, I think, you know, they missed whatever the essential ingredient I brought to the foursome.
Yeah, see, there you go.
And you know, that affected the nature of the group. I think it tended to become more of Proctor and Bergman moderated by Phil Austin instead of, you know, working a little. When you're three, you know, it's like you're in between this thing, you know.
Right, that's right. There's a, it's a, there's there is in comedy. There's like you know, partners or teams work well together, and at three is very hard. Like the Three Stooges were successful at it, but it's almost impossible because there's always one person standing around watching the other.
That's
two.
Right. And if you're a silent character, like of course Harpo, why it's all right. You don't have to
right.
say anything.
It's all right. Sure. That's probably why they did it. You know.
Is there any opportunity, or is there any chance? I'll tell you this. I see that the four of the original members of the Grateful Dead are performing at Soldier's Field in Chicago to celebrate their 50th anniversary. Well, let me put it this way. October of next year is the Firesign Theater's 50th anniversary. So I can't predict what will happen, but something certainly should, don't you think?
Yeah, that's right. I agree. If there's anything I can do to help, let
you're
me know.
On, man. You're on. Right. You're know. On. You're so on let's the committee.
Thank you. Before we go, let's just talk quickly about the different things that you've been involved in, like Don't Crush That Dwarf, Hand Me the Pliers, and all Nick Danger. Those are all available as stage versions, right?
Yes. Waiting for the Electrician and Don't Crush That Dwarf as a kind of double bill, although, of course, each one could be done separately. But Electrician works wonderfully on the stage. We did it many times ourselves in an abbreviated form, and Dwarf, once it's kind of ironed a little flatter than it is on the album, it makes it a little more easy to follow. Is a wonderful stage play which we've done here. Orson, whom you just recently met, played Porgy Tirebiter. The seven albums from Columbia are all, the scripts are all available in a book from the Firesign Theater. The scripts to the radio shows from 1967 in another book. The scripts for all of our stage work in those early years of 67 through, or 68 through 71 or so in the Martian Space Party period. These are all out there and all available. Go to firesidetheater.com and they'll tell you all about that. But the best thing that's coming up is a really cool two DVD set of all of our everything, the television pieces, home movies, the two films, Everything You Know Is Wrong, and Martian Space Party. And lots of other stuff. They keep sending me prints of things that are really amazing. They have a TV show called About a Week, in which we do a whole stage piece, which we stage in my living room, that we were doing at that time on the Ashgrove stage, called the Bob Sideburn News. And so that's that whole piece is reproduced in 1970. On this TV show. So I'm really looking forward to that. And
that's exciting.
Everybody will like to see us in pictures, I'm sure.
Yeah, that's right. I think a lot of people maybe haven't ever seen you on film or video, but that sounds great. It's really exciting. Now, you've also written your memoir, Dr. Firesign's Follies.
That's true. It goes right along with the George Tirebiter novel, the Ronald Reagan murder case. Both of those from BearManor Books, and which publishes hundreds of books by and about B movie and B television actors. And I think Tirebiter belongs right there. He's in perfect company.
He is in perfect company. Have you done the audio books for these yet?
No, I have not done. I have not. No, strange you should ask.
Because that's my other job, is I'm the producer of the BearManor audio.
Well,
books.
So
when you're ready to record them, I'm happy to accept them.
Okay, let's make a deal. we've talked often about doing because the Ronald Reagan murder case was originally based on a half-hour radio play that I did for MRTW, for the Midwest Radio Theater Workshop. And so we've always talked, Judith and I have talked about you know, dramatizing the rest of it and doing it not just as a straight reading, but doing it as a multi-voice piece, and, which would be most fun to do, I think.
Yeah, that's right. I think that would be the best way to do it. I've done a few audiobooks that way myself and turned them into radio theaters instead and, you know, kept the narration, but when it was the action, it was the action.
There you go. Well, let me just drop in one more thing. Otherworld Media, which is Judith's company, of which I am a partner, over all of these years, media production company, has taken over the Mark Time Awards, which were administered in Minneapolis by a couple of great guys, but they got tired of doing it after 17 years. So we've taken over the Mark Time Awards, and we're adding to the Mark Time, which is for the best multicast science fiction production, and the Ogle, which is for the best horror fantasy production. This year, we're adding the Nick Danger Prize for the best detective mystery genre radio production. And and we're giving a Bradshaw in Peter Bergman's honor to several people that I think deserve an award for their work in the field, for their benefit to all of us who are working in the field. And and let's see, and there's one other too. Oh, of course, how could I forget it? The Betty Jo, but everybody knew her as Nancy, which goes to the best actor or actress or both, or, you know, we don't care. You know, it's a picture. Mm. It's a picture of Phil Proctor with a wig, and you know that he does multi-sexual voices. So, we want to make sure that no one is being discriminated against here. So it's the Four Fire Signs and the Ogle and a character named the Runyon, which will be introduced into the for under 18 producers. So there'll be a youth category as well.
Oh, wow.
And that one's named after Runyon Jones, the hero of Norman Corwin's The Odyssey of Runyon Jones, which was the very first radio play I ever read and which introduced me to the idea of writing for radio.
Wow. Well, that's the end.
That's my story.
Thank you. It's not your whole story. You have a really complex and rich story to tell. We couldn't possibly tell it all in a half an hour. But thank you, David Ossman, for being on the Voice Actor Show. And hopefully we're going to now do some improv with my wife for the Comedy-O-Rama Hour. So we can look forward to
that.
Stay tuned.
Interview with David Ossman, one of the four founding members of the Firesign Theatre. You can get all those Firesign Theatre books at BearManorMedia.com. I'm Joe Bev. After the Voice Actor Show, we'll be playing excerpts from How Time Flies, a comedy album written by David Ossman and featuring the voice talents of all four members of the Firesign Theatre, plus several other contributors. It was originally released by Columbia Records in 1973, and be sure to check out the latest Comedy-O-Rama Hour with David Ossman improvising with Lori Kellogg and myself as George Tirebiter. You can listen at all my websites, including joebev.com. If you'd like to write to me, email me at info@waterlog.com and become a fan on Facebook. And if you want to hear more Joe Bev, well, you know where to go.
Waterlog Productions.
Listen to the Comedy-O-Rama Hour with Joe Bev and Lori Kellogg and special guest stars like Rick Overton.
When they gang up in the sleep, they come in to get you. Hundreds of squirrel is too many, and you're, you defeat me, or too many, and now I must die, because they work as group.
Stuart Penkin.
So the knives were flying to the right of me. The knives were flying to the left of me.
Knives, all right.
And all eyes were peeled, and suddenly...
This is when you lost your aunt.
Yes, I'm having a flashback, sorry.
And Julie Newmar.
You're a business lady.
Businessing, yes.
Doing the business.
Yes. I sit and point. I tell people what to do.
Somebody's got to do that. People need direction.
Oh. They do, don't they? I mean, they come back all the time for more directions.
That's the Comedy-O-Rama Hour, one of 15 free podcasts you can hear at waterlogwith2gs.com.
And now, a BearManor radio blast from the past!
System in. Hello, Mark. Punch up. Video assist, please. Retro orbit. Successful. Vehicle. Recovery center. Now in. Contact. Bathroom. Your. Spacesuit.
Landing phase.
L. Semi. Dead. Niner.
Slant.
Autumn. Monitor.
Pig.
Music.
Circus.
Circuit. Circuit. In.
Happy landing!
Mark. Please.
Americans, it's a far, far better thing. This is the first step.
Hello up there!
Who's that down there?
Get in the gantry lift! It still works!
What?
Get in!
Okay. Push down.
Jesus Christ.
Hey, son, you come in right on time. Hope you ain't disappointed there ain't more of a reception. My name's Tweenie. This whole place is abandoned, you know. Nobody cares anymore. I don't care. It's a government job, though. And they're hard to... Ah, here you are.
Welcome to President's Memorial Space Museum.
Well, they didn't tell me what to expect.
Well, they didn't want to bring you down, I suppose. That's a joke. Bring you down. Lift. How you feel?
Well, I feel... I guess I feel all right. I'd like to get out of this suit.
Suit yourself. We got some soft clothes fixed up for you. Right in the hot room. Over there. You go in, wash up, change. Decontaminate yourself, please. I gotta turn on the lights in the old Pegasus hangar. There's a little surprise for you in there.
Really?
Well, not really, but close enough. You gonna be okay?
Yeah, I'm just a little confused. You go ahead and do what you have to do.
Oh, look, I'm just here to help you. Let me hold on to those bulky things for you. Must be the holo log of the trip, right? Well,
that's right. They are a little hard to hold with these... gloves
well,
on.
Well, let me take them off your hands.
All right.
No, no, not the gloves. The tapes.
No, I need
come
to hold on to those.
No, fella. Look at that. You just go get your brains washed. I'll pick these things up.
Listen, be very careful
with
those.
Yeah, go right in there.
None of them are labeled
at all. It's okay. Don't worry about a thing.
Listen, those are very valuable.
Close the door behind you. Please, close that door. Good. I got to send this in. Oh, let's see. Tape secured. S-E-C. Final program. P. Print back. Okay. Whoa, she's cooking now. Hey, what's behind me? Hey, you hungry?
What?
I say, you hungry?
Oh, sure, I could eat something solid. How about some coffee?
Solid coffee? You're grounded now. I got that real thing bubbling here on the flash. You just go ahead and finish that shower.
Hey, listen, what about these big bags of...
Now I just better test these waxworks out again.
The time is now 4:44.
There she goes. Patriotic. A little loud, though. All set. You gonna be much longer?
None of it will be up to shame.
Oh, no, just come on out like you are.
Hey, did you pick up those tapes?
Ask me no questions. And I'll tell you no lies. No sense leaving them big doors open. Look at them mother's bowl. Oh, that's a little cozier now.
I'll just leave the waste bags inside. Hey, Tweenie? Hey, where are you?
Over here! Look! Surprise! Still too damn loud! That's better.
Renting the curtain of the starry night descends bold Pegasus from distant flight. Hail, explorer, hero, friend. Welcome back. Brother Earth, again. How appropriate these innocuous words seem beside the big thrill you must feel as you return down home after 20 long and short years, Mark. And what a similar thrill your real friends and employers would feel if they could be with you now in person. Only the inchoate passage of time has rendered this impractical. Here, however, through the miracle of interloid crystal memory and Bolterama, I am honored to introduce your old chief, Intendant General George Gorgon, commander of the space agency, retired.
My version. Welcome back to the blessed blue world, Mark. That's right. We're still waiting for you down here. And all of us, officers and employees alike, will be so proud and relieved when you make it home. Well, my boy, heaps of changes have gone right on by in the course of time since 79, so I'll expect you'll have a lot to catch up on in your personal life, and so we won't keep you waiting here too long. I know what a fistful of pressure you've been under out there.
Looks real, don't he?
And of course, your back pay and a bonus is waiting for you.
I don't remember.
As well as one heck of a U-Sync service pension plan. I want to recommend it to you. Not to mention a tour with the Active Duty Retirement Corps. So, at ease, Mark. And let's keep in touch.
Thank you, George.
You have just heard a BearManor radio blast from the past. Check out all the great books and audio at BearManorMedia.com.
The withering of Willoughby and the Professor, their ways in the worlds.
This device I fashioned last week has the unique capacity to pucker space.
Pucker?
Yes. Push it this way. Pull it that way. Allow me to demonstrate. Listen as I turn this knob.
What's that?
That is space being puckered this way. Now listen as I turn the knob the other way.
Wow! What's that?
That is space being puckered that way.
Wow!
The Withering of Willoughby and the Professor is available at Amazon and all online vendors. Get it now at waterlog.com. That's waterlog with two G's .com.
Oh, that David Ossman and Joe Bev have both worked for the National Public Radio, and both did shows about the War of the Worlds, and both now live out in the country. Either they had the same idea, or NPR does that to everybody. They is East Coast, West Coast doppelgangers, for goodness sake. I is glad I, Professor Ludwig von Wurtzschmuckerlitz, am in the country and didn't get driven here. I drove myself here, and am here to take care of the Bear Manor, and all of the great radio shows we has for you. Bear Manor has a lot of other good books at BearManorMedia.com. And if you like this audio, you should check out Joe and Laurie's Waterlog.com website. Oh boy, it's great too! They are at Waterlog with 2 G's.com.